Dr. Shirai. She's professor at the Keio University in Tokyo and a visiting scholar at the Asian Development Bank Institute. She was a member of the policy board of the Bank of Japan from 2011 to 2016. She supported the bank's quantitative and qualitative monetary easing problem in 2013, but she voted against the negative interest rate policy in 2016. She has published 11 books on topics including China's exchange rate system, Japan's macroeconomic policy, and the European debt crisis. And she's currently writing a book, most importantly in English, on the Bank of Japan's monetary policy. So I'm delighted to ask her to address us. Professor Shirai, over
Thank
to you.
Thank you. This book you just mentioned, it's going to be published in the beginning of February. And the title will be Mission Incomplete, Reflating Japan's Economy. It's an e-book and it's free. You can download freely from the Asian Development Bank Institute. So okay. I hope you can, if you're interested in BOJ's policy, history of Bank of Japan's policy from 1990s, you know, I have a thorough review. First, before I talk about in detail about the unconventional monetary policy, after Mr. Kuroda became governor, first I'd like to show you how massive the BOJ's monetary easing is as of now. So in order to compare the degree of monetary accommodation across the central banks which are doing unconventional monetary policy, like Sweden, Switzerland, Euro area, Denmark, we can compare central bank's asset as a percent of nominal GDP. Now, Switzerland, I think it's exceptional, because as you know, Switzerland is not really buying government bond. So it's not a really unconventional monetary policy. Switzerland case, they really heavily intervene in a foreign exchange market because Swiss franc is overvalued. So I guess setting aside Switzerland, the Bank of Japan's scale of monetary easing is substantial. So now it's getting toward 90%. So if somebody asks whether BOJ has done sufficient monetary easing, the answer is yes. And there is no doubt that BOJ did a lot of monetary easing. Okay, it's very clear from 2013 April when the Bank of Japan introduced quantitative and qualitative easing, we see a very sharp increase. And then compared to ECB, 30%, there's a big divergence. So you can see that BOJ did a lot of monetary easing. Let's look at the inflation over this period. European people often looking at Japan and say we should look at Japan's case and try to avoid the Japan's problem, right? So whenever European and American central bankers, when they say about Japan, they often say deflation. So Japan had a deflation problem, so we should avoid such kind of deflation. But if you look at average inflation, this is between 2000 to March 2013, just before this quantitative, qualitative monetary easing was introduced. It was minus 0.28. So it's not really very serious deflation spiral. I hope you will not misunderstand. I think many people are misunderstanding. So Japan's past deflation, it was deflation, but it's very mild. So it's like a 0%, nearly 0% inflation. So nothing is serious. But it just, price always had a relatively downward trend. Now, later I'll talk about CPI. This is so from QQE, from April 2013, the BOJ started QQE. This sharp rise, this of which 2% come from consumption tax hike. So if you remove that, it's just 1%. So it's not that remarkable. Okay, so but I just wanted to show you the actual inflation from consumer's perspective. It went to the 3.6. So there was a very sharp, very strong inflation. But in terms of central bankers' point of view, we exclude consumption tax hike. Okay, it's not that remarkable. And later I would like to explain you that Bank of Japan's QQE policy, we targeted monetary base. Nowadays, I think ECB doesn't use monetary risk. I looked at the ECB data. There's no indicator called monetary base. So I guess ECB doesn't use it. But in Japan, we intentionally introduced monetary base target, which is the sum of notes in circulation and marginal bank's current account at central bank. So you can see both central bank's asset, monetary base, and they increase together at the same pace. So before I go into what you have done over these 3 years, I'd like to show you the transformation of this QE. So initially, April 2013, the Bank of Japan introduced this QE, and in 2014, October, it expanded. These are the global. And then last January, following the ECB policies, the BOJ introduced negative interest rate. And then last July, the BOJ expanded. And last September, interestingly, BOJ introduced new yield curve control, meaning that pegging the 10-year yield at 0%. Okay, so this is the rough pictures. And by the way, these classifications I made, BOJ never say that. BOJ just say, this is QQE, this is QQE with negative interest rate, QQE with yield curve control. But because I know I'm an academician, and from a conceptual point of view, it's totally changed the framework. So this is my classification, and I think in terms of framework, the negative interest rate really created a big difference from existing framework, so as this yield curve control. So I think it's better to look at this way, if we to understand BOJ's policy. Now here, if you're interested in data, please look at it. I just wanted to show how similar ECB and Bank of Japan's policy are. Both are buying various large-scale assets, negative interest rate is introduced, and also concessional lending program like TrueTron. We have very similar tools. The probably difference is that the Bank of Japan purchased ETF, REIT means Real Estate Investment Trust, which whereas ECB doesn't buy stocks. So that are differences. And also BOJ doesn't buy local government bond. Of course, we don't buy supra bond. So that there are some differences. But basically, it's very similar between BOJ and ECB's approach. I think we are learning from each other. I know ECB get a lot of insight from BOJ's policy, and so are us. So now I'd like to show you what BOJ has done since 2013. Now, Mr. Kuroda became governor at the end of March 2013. Now, I spent 2 years with previous governor, Shirakawa, and 3 years with Kuroda. Now, it's very important to explain you what's happened before that. So, Abe and LDP, his party, Liberal Democratic Party, used to be opposition parties. And then in December 2012, they won. So Abe became prime minister. And during this election campaign, he said he will introduce 2% inflation target. He will introduce massive monetary easing. And to get that three arrows. So the first arrow is this massive monetary easing. Second arrow is a massive fiscal surplus, a fiscal stimulus. Third arrow is economic growth strategies. So already he was planning to introduce 2% to the Bank of Japan. So having said that, so he became prime minister at the end of December 2012. January, under the joint declaration between Bank of Japan and government, the BOJ introduced 2% under previous governorship. Now, at that time, there was a problem because even though BOJ said, okay, we will introduce 2% inflation target, but the monetary easing conducted under Shirakawa's governorship was not enough. There was an asset purchase program, but it never very massive. So no market participant believed that BOJ can achieve 2% with existing framework. So then Mr. Kuroda came, because Mr. Kuroda and there are two deputy governor. One is Iwata. So the Mr. Kuroda and Iwata are long-term critique of Bank of Japan. They are always, you know, writing a lot of books and then, you know, and saying the BOJ has never done sufficient monetary easing. So they also said before they were nominated that they can achieve 2% in 2 years. So with that confidence, I think they were selected. And so Kuroda's governorship, we decided to introduce QQE. And so when the BOJ introduced this monetary easing, so the BOJ said we will try to achieve 2% as soon as possible with a time horizon of about 2 years. And the BOJ will continue this QQE as long as necessary to achieve 2% target in stable money. And here, what I said earlier, so we used to have a policy rate target, like a federal fund rate, but we switched to the monetary base. It doesn't mean the Bank of Japan believed in quantity theory of money, like a clear relationship between monetary base and inflation and inflation expectation. It wasn't that. But I know some people believed in that, like Mr. Iwata, deputy governor. He's a monetarist, so he was a strong believer of quantity theory of money. But like me or Mr. Kuroda or others, we don't really think that there is a very clear relationship between monetary base and inflation. So why we introduce monetary base? Because I think we really wanted to give impression to people that BOJ this time was very different. Because in the past, BOJ always did a lot of monetary easing, but could never achieve the goal, and could never get rid of overvalued yen. So a lot of people, not domestically, but from abroad, and foreign central bankers, they all criticized Bank of Japan, saying BOJ have never done enough. Maybe BOJ is not really want to generate inflation. Maybe they want to have a deflation. So a lot of people criticize. So I think we really need to introduce something very dramatic. So we wanted to show that we really want to increase quantity. So as a symbol of quantity, we thought that it may be easy for people to understand if we set a target on monetary base. Because monetary base is a sum of notes in circulation and a commercial bank's reserve placed as central bank. So it includes notes in circulation. So even in public, probably if we say if we use quantity target, probably they understand, okay, this time BOJ will really increase lots of liquidity, so that will lead to inflation. So that was an original idea. So in order to achieve this monetary base target, initially the target was 60 to 70 trillion yen. In terms of US dollars, it's like 550 to 650 billion annually. That's quite a lot. And so in order to achieve monetary base target, the BOJ Bank of Japan needed to buy Japanese government bond. Because in Japan, we don't have a very big corporate bonds market or asset-backed security. I think similar in ECB. After all, the major asset that ECB or Bank of Japan can buy is government bond. So basically, a Japanese government bond is most important asset. So initially, to achieve 60 to 70 trillion annual expansion of monetary base, the BOJ decided to purchase 50 trillion of government bond. The remaining will be filled out by a purchase of a treasury bill and ETF, stocks, 1 trillion, and a real estate investment trust, 30 billion. And then we purchased Japanese government bond all after 40 years, the maximum. Then the problem happened from April 2014, when this consumption tax hike was implemented from 5 to 8%. Demand started to drop. And probably the decline in demand was greater than BOJ expected. And in the meanwhile, oil price started to drop from summer of 2014. So we started to see inflation decelerating, and inflation expectation also started to decelerate. And as a central banker, we felt that we should do something to improve this situation. So that's why in October 2014, the BOJ decided to expand this monetary easing. So monetary base target was increased from 60 to 70 to 80, and the Japanese government bond purchase increased from 50 to 80. And also we increased ETF and REIT. So it was very massive. So how big this 80 trillion is? Right now, Japanese government net issuance of Japanese government bond annually is 50, 50. So BOJ buying 80, so means that we are really taking, the BOJ is really taking JGB from investors. So you can see how big this program is. Then last January, the BOJ decided to introduce negative interest rate. Why we introduce it? I think you remember, there was a global uncertainty. And China's economy started to fluctuate from summer 2015. The Chinese stock prices started to collapse. The exchanges started to depreciate. So also January last year, the Chinese economy had a lot of fragility. Oil price started to drop, so emerging economies also started to become very fragile. In the meanwhile, Deutsche Bank program, low profitability issue was closed up. So in Europe, the banking sector concerns started to rise. So globally, there was a risk-off environment. Now, under that situation, BOJ felt also there's no problem with regards to domestic demand, but because the external environment is deteriorating, if we don't take any action, maybe situation gets deteriorated. Maybe corporate sector's mindset will start to deteriorate. So that was the main reason why BOJ decided to introduce negative interest rate. By the way, I voted against it. And later I'll explain why. And then, to be honest, I was right. I know I was right. And so BOJ in January, introduced this QQE, they call it QQE with negative interest rate. So then they say they will maintain this QQE with negative interest rate as long as necessary to achieve 2% target in stable money. And they said the BOJ will not hesitate to add monetary easing in three dimensions: quantity, qualitative, and quality interest rate. Meaning that if it's necessary, BOJ is willing to expand the annual pace of monetary base above 80. So it means JGB purchase above 80. And quality means ETF, stocks, or REIT. So BOJ is willing to buy more risk assets if necessary, and in deep interest rate. That was our message. Now, this negative interest is very different from yours, ECB. Because the ECB, you apply minus 0.4% interest rate on excess reserves and deposit facility. So basically, you have a one-layer system. In the case of Japan, we decided to introduce three types. So existing plus 0.1 and 0% and minus 0.1 to avoid the burden on the side of banking sector. Because if we charge everything, if we charge negative interest rate to all balances, then the commercial bank have to pay a lot of money to us. Right? Minus 0.1% means they have to pay to central bank. So BOJ wanted to avoid such kind of burden, so it introduced complicated three-layer system. And last July, BOJ doubled the ETF purchases, 6 trillion. Actually, this will cost us potential central bank's risk, which I really want to discuss with you. Because no central bank in the world is purchasing stocks. So what is the implication of for the central bank buying such a large amount of stocks? And how big is it? So now annually, the BOJ purchased ETF of 6 trillion. Where the BOJ's allowances and the capital reserves is only 7. By the end of Mr. Kuroda's governorship, which will end in early April next year, Mr. Kuroda's governorship end. By that time, the BOJ's holding of stocks will be 20 trillion. Okay. If the central bank's allowance capital only amounts to 7 trillion, what does it mean? In case stock prices go down, there will be very significant central bank risk. So this is part one issue I want to discuss with you. I know ECB discussed about the possible purchase of stocks, but they decided not. So, but only BOJ is doing it. So this is one contentious issue. So then very interesting happened. The BOJ had a monetary policy meeting on January 29th, Friday, I remember. So Friday, when they announced it, market initially reacted positively. Positive reaction means, in the central bank's jargon, it means increase in stock prices and exchange rate depreciation. So that exactly happened. And following working day, which is Monday, so February 1st, continued. So stock prices continues to go up, the yen continues to depreciate. But from Saturday, February 2nd, things reversed significantly. It's like just like a Trump victory last year had a reverse impact in the market, like stock prices and exchanges, same thing happened. So from Saturday, all of a sudden, yen started to appreciate. It continues to appreciate up to the June 23rd. In Japan, time, June 24th, Brexit referendum. At that time, yen dollar rate went below 100. Okay, that was a bit too much. And so stock prices also continues to go down. So the market reaction completely changed. So in retrospect, why people reacted negatively on this negative interest rate? Now, I summarize as follows. First of all, I think BOJ had a communication problem because under Shirakawa and also under Kuroda, BOJ always rejected the idea of negative interest rate. So even when the ECB introduced negative interest rate in June 2014, of course, foreigner would say, why not BOJ introduce negative interest rate? But the BOJ strongly rejected the idea of negative interest rate. Why? Because I will tell you, in the case of Japan, we could see the negative impact. So also Mr. Kuroda kept rejecting the idea of negative interest rate. So when it was introduced all of a sudden, everybody got surprised. And I guess it took a while for foreign investors to really understand and grasp the idea. So once they started to really know what it means, I think they started to react negatively. Because one problem is, remember, BOJ used to say, we are willing to expand quantity, and then if they can do that, why not expanding quantity, monetary base, rather than introducing negative interest rate? So it was not consistent with the previous communication. That is one issue. The second issue, here is the difference between ECB and Japan. Now, in case of Japan, negative interest rate really works against the asset purchase program. I talked about this with ECB, and they didn't get it for a while because the situation is totally different. In the euro area and in Ireland, you have a negative interest rate, but it doesn't work against continuation of asset purchase program in Europe, but Japan, yes. Where the difference come from? I can give you an example. For example, Ireland, there is a government bond. Who own it? I hear that most of the government bond are owned by foreign investors, foreign commercial banks. And then domestic commercial banks do not hold that much government bond. Same in Germany. More than 50% of German bonds are owned by foreigners. So in other words, ECB and Central Bank of Ireland, they can purchase easily the government bond from foreigners. In the case of Japan, it's different. We have a huge Japanese government bond, right? Size is over 200% of GDP. Huge market. But interesting thing is 95% of this outstanding Japanese government bond are owned by domestic people. And it's highly concentrated. The investor base is highly concentrated. It's basically owned by commercial banks or institutional investors like pension fund, insurance companies. Now, why commercial bank holds so much Japanese government bond? Here comes the difference. For example, Ireland, when we look at Ireland banking sector, loan to deposit ratio of the total banking sector. Here, I hear that it is 100, over 100, right? So that means banks can lend. They can extend credit to the household and corporate sector, but the Japan, no. For always in Japan, even before QQE was introduced, there is not much demand for credit. So on average, this loan to deposit ratio is about 60%, 60. So lots of deposit are growing, but a very limited demand for credit. So there is a 40% gap. So the Japanese government bond used to fill out this gap between this deposit and loans. So the Japanese government bond is very important for commercial bank because there are not much alternatives, right? And mega banks, they can invest abroad, but the small community banks, they don't have a skill to invest abroad, and they don't know how to hedge. So basically, they needed Japanese government bond. So Bank of Japan has to buy the Japanese government bond from domestic people. So then you have to really look at the domestic people and incentive. So BOJ needed to give incentive to commercial bank so that they are willing to sell the government bonds to Bank of Japan. Suppose I'm a banker, say Tokyo Mitsubishi, and I have so much Japanese government bond now. So if I keep this Japanese government bond until maturity, I can get at least coupon income, right? Until maturities. Or I can sell my Japanese government bonds to Bank of Japan at higher prices. Right, so I can get capital gain today. But what I will do with this cash after that, if the credit demand is little, then usually the banks will keep those money at the deposit current account of Bank of Japan. Right? So traditionally, the Bank of Japan used to pay plus 0.1% interest, so I could sell easily my Japanese government bond to Bank of Japan, then at least I could get 0.1% interest. So positive interest rate was really incentive for the BOJ to continue this smooth functioning of asset purchase program. So therefore, it's totally different from your countries. So we knew that. So that's why we rejected this idea. Naturally, when the negative interest rate was introduced to the margin, that means that to the newly increased current account, of course people will not sell it, right? Because why shall I sell it if I just get minus 0.1? So naturally, it worked against smooth operation of asset purchase program. I knew that. That's why I oppose it. If we look at the Bank of Japan's statement, public statement, issued in January 29th, out of 9, 4 people dissented, and 3 people are regular dissenters. But I was different because I always worked very closely with Mr. Kuroda and Bank of Japan. I'm one of the very important theoretical founder of QQE, And then, so we had a very close relationship, working relationship. So when people saw my name, I hear that everybody was quite shocked. So, and then, of course, I didn't want to vote against it. And also, I know they didn't want me to vote against it, but I didn't have a choice because it was inconsistent. Logically, conceptually, and from operational wise, there's no justification for me. So as long as we could continue asset purchase program for a while, we should not have introduced that. That was my idea. So banks, what happened? Later I will show you data. So banks, you know, in Japan, the credit growth is not so much, 2 to 3% only. And too many banks, more banks than Europe. We have too many over-banking sector, lots of competition. So already, lending to deposit interest rate margin was so low, like 0.8%. So if we introduce negative interest rate, the lending rate will go down further. So that naturally, interest margin will be squeezed more. Already this was foreseen. So the direct impact on banks will be very severe. So we, that's why another reason why I voted against. There are many other issues, one more issue. What happened to household? The household, they didn't realize the difference between interest rate, negative interest rate charge on commercial banks and the retail deposit rate that they get. So when the negative interest rate was introduced, I hear that a lot of household got worried. So they made a thousand of phone calls to local banks and asked what will happen to their deposit. Then there's a household survey which shows what do you think about interest rate. So after negative interest rate, many people say interest rate is too low. Mm-hmm. So actually, it really didn't help to increase aggregate demand. Rather than that, household got worried. I think similar thing happening in Germany. Okay. So to summarize, this, I think negative interest rate was not really working in Japan. Consistency issue, I already told you. And this is three-layer system. It's far more complicated than ECB. So this is another reason why almost nobody understands DOJ's complicated system. So it's very complicated. And since this is the interest rate margin, it's so squeezed, you know. And it's the lowest if we compare Japan and European banks. This margin is lowest among the country economies which introduce negative interest rate. Another issue is that this yield curve became too flat. If interest rate is almost flat after 10 years, how can banks can get money through maturity transformations? And also, institutional investors felt this is too low. Because at one point, 10-year yield went down to minus 0.3%, and everybody said that is too low. It is not good for institutional investors because return is low, but also discount rate become lower. Right? So the pension liability, present value of pension liability also expanded. So corporate sector's pension fund also had a problem. So actually, a lot of people started to complain. So last September, the BOJ introduced yield curve control. Why? I think there was two reasons for that. One, because since January, when the negative interest rate was introduced, there was a growing criticism from banking sector and insurance industry about the adverse impact. So I think BOJ realized maybe interest rate went too low. So by introducing the pegging of 10-year yield at 0%, they can stop this further decline in a 10-year yield. Right? At the same time, they can prevent overshooting. So I think it was inevitable for Bank of Japan at that point to introduce this pegging system in order to avoid further cut in a yield curve. That is one reason. I think most important reason is because of the growing anxiety in the financial sector, and I think BOJ needed to correct the side effect caused by negative interest rate. Another problem is that, remember, BOJ buy 80 trillion Japanese government bond. That is a bit too much. If BOJ continues to buy it, what will happen to commercial bank? Nothing there. So everybody worry about it. And I think it's a growing stress is generated in the Japanese government board. So BOJ really wanted to move away from volume approach, like a monetary base, to interest rate focus. So that's why they shifted from monetary base control to yield curve control. Essentially, they abandoned the volume target. Okay? But here comes a problem. There's a lot of problem now. You know, when the Bank of Japan announced this system, all central banks, I believe, understood as follows. Okay, this must be the following case. The BOJ may find it increasingly difficult to purchase 80 trillion Japanese government bond. So they need to move away from volume. And that's why they switch to yield curve. I think this is the interpretation of ECB and many of the central bankers, experts in the world. Okay? Here comes the problem. Okay? So that is the interpretation of central bankers. That is the interpretation of me, myself. Okay, but there is a unique expression here. At the same time, in September, the Bank of Japan introduced the following expression. It's called inflation overshooting commitment. So monetary base will expand until inflation exceeds 2% and stay above 2% in stable manner. I thought that they got out of monetary base target, but the monetary base is here. So continue to expand. Then there was another expression there below that. And they say BOJ project to expand, BOJ expect that the JGB purchase will continue. 80 trillion yen JGB purchases will continue until end of this year. Then people got confused. We thought you got out of volume, no? But you are saying you will continue 80 trillion until end of this year. How can you do that? Because technically, if the Bank of Japan target 10-year yield, the amount of JGB purchases has to be endogenously determined. You can't target volume and yield, right? So if you really shift it to the volume target, then you don't need 80 trillion, because we don't know how much we need, right? If it's so, and then this created confusion, okay? And so right now, if you talk to the hedge fund, they often talk all the time on TV, like Bloomberg and CNBC. Yesterday, I saw the one of the guy from hedge fund was talking about Japan. BOJ is different. Because they introduce 0% interest rate. So whenever there is upward pressure, they will always buy more to exert downward pressure. What does it mean? Meaning that there might be cases that BOJ have to buy more than 80 trillions in order to maintain 0% peg. So then what will be the BOJ's intention? Does BOJ really want to move away from massive purchase? Maybe want to have a tapering because you know, it's getting harder to do it? Or BOJ really want to target 0%? If it is so, then BOJ should be ready to purchase Japanese government bond as much as possible, and then they should not hesitate to purchase above 80. Is that the real Japanese BOJ's intention? It's not clear. Okay? So there's a confusion. So among central bankers, they all understand the way I did. But the investors interpret totally different way. Okay? So to summarize, what was the impact of this QQE? I think I can say at least the Bank of Japan was able to correct overvaluation currency. It used to be very high, this deadline. It used to be very high, and now at least we got out of overvaluation. So that was good. And also stock prices used to be too low, also that we corrected. So that is two good things, effectiveness of BOJ's policy. But other things, for example, let's look at credit growth. This is a credit growth. Do you see any pickup? No, right? So then the QQE, despite the very large scales, was not able to generate higher credit growth. You see, nothing changed. Instead, before this was growing more, because after negative interest rate, some money market funds were not able to make money in the interbank market. They closed it. So the money shifted to deposit. So ironically, loan to deposit ratio dropped furthermore. If you look at the GDP, over 3 years, average GDP growth was 1.1%, okay? Which was okay, but 2012, 1 year before QQE was introduced, was 0.9. So slight improvement. Most importantly, this potential economic growth is 0.2%. I hear that Irish potential economic growth is 3%. I envy it. 0.2. So our economy hardly grows. So without increase in potential economic growth, I think it's very difficult to see sustainable impact of unconventional monetary easing. Okay. So this is I quickly went over the issue. So finally, so the issue is what have we learned from unconventional monetary policies? First, I think we can say unconventional monetary policy were effective in terms of lowering short-term interest rate and long-term interest rate, both in nominal and real term. Same in Japan, same in Europe, no doubt. So in that sense, I think central bankers did a very good job. How about impact on asset prices and exchange rate? I think we can say those are quite effective, especially in the initial stage. But after that, the impact are mixed, depending on the investor's sentiment, the investor's view about monetary easing and global economic condition. For example, last September, when the Bank of Japan introduced this yield curve control, there was no impact on stock prices and yen. But when Trump won during the US election, all of a sudden, US interest rates started to go up. Then, German interest rate, Irish interest rate, all increased, but not as much as US. So of course you had an interest rate ratio. But Japan, pegging the 10-year yield at 0%, so this interest differential was the widest. That leads to the speculators' change in their perception. Before, they bet on the yen's appreciation, but after Trump's victory, they switch to the yen's depreciation speculation. If you look at the hedge fund positions, so before elections, their position was long in yen, but after that, switched to short in yen. So it really depends on how investors think. So now all the investors say, oh, BOJ's policy is very good, it's very effective, and so there's no doubt we can really bet on the yen depreciation. And a lot of hedge funds say yen dollar rate can go to like 130. Some people say 140. To me, that's crazy. I think households get furious about that if we reach to that depreciation. So that is how hedge funds are doing speculation. So it depends on the hedge fund. If the hedge fund thinks it's effective, they will bet on that direction. But if not, they change it. So I think nowadays, the impact of unconventional monetary policy really depends on how those investors feel. So it's not really clear. I don't think we can generalize that. What about impact on credit growth and aggregate demand? The effectiveness, I think we can see some effectiveness, especially in the initial stage. But after that, I think once unconventional monetary policy stayed too long, people forget. And people even do not question the sustainability. They just take it for granted. So low interest rate become normal. Then people do not really pay attention. Then effectiveness starts to gradually weaken. That's what's happening in Japan. I think what's happening in Europe in general. So in terms of the impact on aggregate demand, I think it's not that effective if we do it too long. And instead, the problem is that if you continue unconventional monetary easing for too long, we don't see a positive impact, right? But instead, instability program emerge, financial instability program, like a distortion and the profitability on the banking sector and so on. So there's a greater financial instability risk rather than benefit. So that is, I think, a problem we are seeing now. Now, what about the impact of negative interest rate? I looked at Sweden and many other countries in detail. My conclusion is that the adverse impact of negative interest rate depend on one, cash prevalence of society, whether the country use cash a lot, and two, loan growth. If the loan growth is high, the banking sector can offset decline in profitability caused by negative interest rate. Also, degree of competition in the banking sector. If you don't have a lot of banks, then maybe you can charge higher lending rate. And also the existence of alternative income sources. This is the example. Notes in circulation as a percent of nominal GDP. Red is Japan. You see, means Japan is a very cash-oriented society. So after negative interest rate, this notes in circulation started to go up even more. So there was a shift from deposit to cash. Okay? But nothing happened in Sweden. Sweden, and this ratio is dropping because that economy is highly technology oriented. The commercial bank do not have any cash at bank, right? People do not use cash. Under such kind of society, just because negative interest rate is introduced, people are not willing to go back to cash-based economy. So there's no severe negative impact, but Japan is different. So depending on the country's prevalence of cash, okay, also credit depend on the credit growth. If the credit growth is not high, then bank cannot get profit. Unresolved issue. Based on my understanding of Japan and Europe, and also the United States, I think we have to question whether decline in short-term and long-term interest rate always good thing. Traditional textbooks often say if the economy is not strong, we can lower interest rate to stimulate. But there may be cases that declining interest rate goes too far, that will no longer generate any strong positive impact. I think that is the one lesson we learn. The question is, what threshold leads to such kind of situation? I don't know clearly, but I think academics really can talk about that. This conflict I already talked. Another issue I really want to talk with is balance sheet risk. Central bank are taking too much risk as a result of unconventional monetary policy. When they start to normalize by raising interest rate, I think some of central bank in your euro area, possibly Ireland and Germany particularly, also definitely Japan, may face a deficit for a while. And maybe they use up all the reserves and then they will have a negative equity. Now, can we, under that situation, if you know that someday the central bank have a such kind of problem, the question is, should central bank still continue to do unconventional monetary policy to achieve 2% target? I think this is one issue not solved yet. And so final issue is, what would be the best combination between fiscal policy and monetary policy? If you look at the Japan, the debt is 250%. There is no sign of very strict fiscal discipline. And if we just now the government term expand fiscal policy, I mean, can we really improve the government fiscal discipline? Maybe we might undermine the fiscal discipline even more. So this is a quite important issue. So I stop here and I'd like to get discussion with you.